time to talk antiques once again. We got four of us, and we're looking for another one.
We got a lively bunch here this
morning. I bet he's listening on the radio saying, oh, no, I'm in trouble.
So we got 80% of the 100.
80% of the 100's here. But anyway, it's Christmas time, and these fellas have got it all lined up with a good show, I'm sure.
Boy, we had some sharp people last week, didn't
we? Yes, we did, boy.
They knew their show.
They had a lot of folks comment on this show last week.
Yeah.
How good it was.
We put our decorations on the tree Friday night, and then watched the movie afterwards. And
it was
good to point out the spots where you could have answered the questions on.
Wow.
Did you point out the legs that you was going to have to give away?
Oh, no.
Matter of fact,
nobody got all 10. Remember?
Well, there's a bunch of winners out there that's going to be complaining if you don't get them.
Yeah. Well, you said they had, was it 10 or 12?
Yeah, no, you had to get all of them.
Was
right.
It 12?
Oh, you had to get them all.
I think it was 12, wasn't it?
Okay, 12 then. All right.
What are the odds?
Well, I can tell you what the odds were, slim and none, because nobody
slim
does.
Slim and none, yeah.
That saves your hide.
Yeah.
All right, so today there is this new thing that's come out for little kids that's went crazy. And so I know our listeners are running by their kids and grandkids when I'm right.
Yeah, I'm sure they've probably got four or five of each of these under the tree.
Take off, Mr. Producer.
Yeah. It's Hatchimals are the hot gift this year for kids. They are, let's see, the world's most successful branding company, the MPT Group. The hit says that the hit toy this year is Hatchimals, fuzzy little creatures that hatch from an egg when you rub and tap on it. But if you haven't grabbed one, you're probably out of luck for the holidays by this point. And they were supposed to cost $59.99 at retail stores, but they've all been sold out for a long time. But you can get on eBay and pick you one up.
So when you're talking about these Hatchimals, Beanie Baby comes into mind for me.
Yeah.
And then other.
Exactly.
There's been other toys at Christmas pet rock that people fought over, you know, at Christmas time. So
these are a little more interactive than those.
No, I didn't see none of those at Walmart.
Well, that's because they're all bought up.
All bought up, huh?
Yeah, these here. So after they hatch out, they sing and dance, and they'll answer simple questions. So they're little electronic toys,
mm-hmm.
And they've got I assume it's a male and female that'll come out of the egg, and then there's five different species that they divide into: the draggles, the pinguals, the alicorns, the birtles, and the barakeets. And so it's just the toy this year to get. So
the birtle's a cross between a bird and a turtle.
Right. The barakeets is a bear and a parakeet.
Mm-hmm.
The draggles and pingulas look like penguins. I assume the draggles are dragons and something. Alicorns are a cross between, or an owl with a unicorn horn. So,
mm-hmm.
You know, just little fuzzy mixture things.
So it's the hottest Christmas toy right now?
It is. And you could probably still got time to get a buy it now off eBay.
What are those selling for on there?
Well, the number one was actually four that were sold together, which went for $25,000.
Now we're talking about something that costs $59.
Yes. And these are unopened because you can't tell what's in them before they open. Although they're saying that they think they know what they are. But, so $25,000 with one bid for four of these things.
They give them free shipping, you know.
Yeah, that was free shipping. And then here's another one. Went for $20,000 with just a single one of them. Two weeks ago.
Don't forget the free shipping.
Free shipping. And another one sold for $15,000 was the buy it now on it. With just one.
Here's the deal.
The same guy sold all three of those.
Here's the deal where it was. So this was the first auction, the highest price auction we have. It was 30 bids for three of them and $7,600 for those three.
Now, they were given 25 grand for one. Now here comes some guy and sells three of them for seven.
Four, 25,000.
Oh,
yeah. This was when they were just starting to get hard to find.
Yeah, the $7,600 was from October 24th. So you jump to the end of November and you get $5,000. Buy it now for two. Here's another one where two of them sold for $3,000. And then
they really took a dive there.
And then they took a dive. And so we got 11 bids for $202.50 for one.
I thought it said a lot of two.
Yeah, that was two. You're right.
From Germany.
They don't have it in the picture. Then we've got they were asking $2,500.
That's back in November, though.
November. 13 Hatchimals. They were asking $2,800 and took a best offer.
That was in November, the 25th.
And then here's a set of 14 that sold as a buy it now for $2,350.
At December 12th.
Had any of you fellas heard of these?
I haven't.
I've heard of them.
I hadn't heard a word of it.
Luckily, my kids are just starting to outgrow this stuff, although my youngest she'd probably love to have one, but it's not been brought up, so I'm not going to. Hopefully,
I'm not going
to
bring it up too much.
She's not going to see the show.
She's out of town today, so she's not listening to the show.
So there's 10 different ones if you collect them all. 12?
Well,
five with two.
No, you're right. There's 10.
So if you collected them all, that wouldn't be too bad.
Yeah. And there's others that are like large lots between 12 and 14 that go for about $2,000, it seems like. So
they don't have buying that 14 there, they still don't have no guarantee that they're gonna get all 10.
You're right. So if you paid a retail price for these and there's one under the tree, I'd unwrap it and put it as a buy it now real quick on eBay.
Yeah, and then buy them something else.
Buy them something else.
There you go. A whole lot nicer than what you had under the tree.
Make your down payment on a car.
Yeah. Well, it might even buy a car if you sold one earlier.
There you go. Yeah, no doubt. If you'd had that top one.
$25,000.
$25,000
for three of them. Four of them.
There you go. Yeah. So that's not a bad investment. What was that? A $240 investment for. To $25,000.
My luck, they'd all be the same one.
And what's your estimate on how much you can pay for it in the summertime?
Dave? $5.
$5. Say so. If they're not already broken and just in the trash by then.
Now, how many different versions are there of the Hatchables?
There's 10.
10.
So I guess that's what next year they can come out with.
Oh, they'll pick out one.
A little more features. New electronic features. So. Okay, well that's the big toy of the year.
Yeah, I was curious. I looked up Tickle Me Elmo to see how much those are going for.
Well, how much are they?
If you still have one in the box, you can sell it for $50, according to eBay. If it's opened, around $10.
What did they used to bring when they first
came? That was a hot toy one Christmas.
I don't know. Yeah, that was the big thing.
I stood in line for that one. I actually got that one.
Apparently, they reissued a 10th anniversary Tickle Me Elmo, I guess, in the early 2000s. Yeah, they're going for $50 untouched and $10 if it's been opened.
Oh, well, so much for that investment. Okay, so moving on to
our next item.
All right, and it's common practice among collectors to find a certain something. Collectors may pay almost anything to have it. The more unusual or odd only adds to the excitement of acquiring it. So eBay dealer Loretta Crinchco auctioned the Connecticut hotel key for room 22, where Marilyn Monroe stayed in 1956 while dating playwright Arthur Miller. She was hoping the key would excite buyers' interest, like the auction recently of her Marilyn Monroe's dress that she wore when she sang Happy Birthday to President JFK, which sold for $4.8 million. So she was hoping to cash in on that, you know, $4 million. Jump on the wagon. There you go.
Bought the dress. That would have been
a better idea. So she put it up on auction on eBay and got $131 for it to a local woman for nostalgia's sake, the dealer said. Kretschko, who runs an antique store with her husband, bought the key with some other sets when the property changed hands 2 years ago. And during the time Monroe stayed at the inn, Miller lived in nearby Roxbury. And so there you go. So nostalgic room key does not bring a lot of money.
Not like a dress.
Not like a dress. So I pulled up some room keys or hotel keys, and the highest fetching one we have was a brass key fob from Mammoth Hotel in Yellowstone Park, Wyoming, which I was at, but I didn't stay at this summer. And it got 13 bids and $502. And it's a nice, it's the part that's, you know, says the room number and stuff like that on a nice brass key fob engraved, but no key on it. Then we've got an antique brass key ring with the Topeka, Kansas City Jayhawk Hotel with the sports mascot on it. Brought $334 with 23 bids. And then a 61 vintage hotel keys, key fobs, tags from like things such as the Stardust Hotel, the Tropicana, and several in Hawaii. Brought $323 with 16 bids on that. Here's a really nice one from...
That's a skeleton key.
Is it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's okay.
Agua Caliente, Tijuana, Mexico, from Las Vegas, from 1925 to 1935. hotel key fob and key... was $300 with the buy it now. And it's a very pretty one for that. So all these are bringing more than Marilyn's key. Mm-hmm. Seems kind of surprising.
Go to Marilyn Monroe.
All right, let me hit Marilyn here. Let's see. Okay. We got so for closed auctions on Marilyn, we have Andy Warhol painting of Marilyn that's got odd colors, you know, green, a red background, green hair, yellow face, stuff like that.
That was from a live auction event, wasn't it?
Yeah.
That might be the reason all these girls are coloring their hair pink. I've even seen guys with pink hair.
There you go.
Where'd this fad come from, I wonder?
I think the peacock started it.
Peacock.
You sell your stuff like that in those international auction houses.
It is.
During the live auction.
So that painting, the Andy Warhol painting, brought $30,000 of four bids.
Yeah, but that was at Sotheby's.
Yeah. And we have an Elliot Erwitt photograph of Marilyn. It was 12 bids. It went for $30,000.
That's probably an original photograph, and he's probably a really famous photographer.
So.
All right, give us one more. When we come back, we'll give him a few more items. There you go. There's a good one right there.
Here you go. Here's a near mint December 1953 Playboy magazine signed by Hugh Hefner with Marilyn Monroe in it. $8,800 with 73 bids.
All right, with that, let's take a break.
All right, more Let's Talk Antiques on the way next on Thunder Radio.
Do you need a part for your car that the dealer just wants too much money for? Well, bring your toolbox and pull the part yourself for huge savings at the CFC Auto Salvage Pick and Pull on Highway 55 between Tullahoma and Manchester. No walking through waist-high weeds here. All of our vehicles are located in our graveled parking lot, up on blocks with room to work. We stock hundreds of cars and trucks, foreign and domestic, new and old, with new vehicles added weekly. You can even search our entire vehicle inventory online. And if your old vehicle gives up the ghost, bring it by. We offer top dollar for your salvage vehicle. Open to the public 7 days a week until dark, so there's plenty of time to come by. That's CFC Auto Salvage Pick and Pull.
Madeline's Antiques and Uniques at 6107 Murfreesboro Road in Manchester has been helping collectors find just the right thing since 2008. With 40 quality dealers and a constantly changing inventory of collectibles from the 1800s to the present, they have many unique items in the store and new things coming in daily. Are you looking for the perfect lamp or clock to finish your collection? A vintage lunchbox from your childhood? Well, you can find that plus any number of other unique items in their huge building. With their easy access off I-24, they meet many travelers from around the world and just around the corner that come to buy and sell antiques, or just to stop and have a free cup of coffee and a cookie while browsing around the store. Come visit owner Madeline Kemp and travel back in time at Madeline's Antiques and Uniques. So many memories.
My name's John Hirschman. I'm one of the original six owners of P&H Rentals. Started the company 30 years ago when we saw a need for individual, construction, industrial, and commercial storage. We have trailers and containers for lease and sale. Our physical location is 2947 Old Manchester Highway, Tullahoma, Tennessee. My phone number is area code 931-273-4252.
The Jiffy Burger on the Hillsborough Boulevard in Manchester has been voted as having the best hamburgers in Manchester. Hometown atmosphere, historical memorabilia, and of course those great burgers, salads, chicken, and so much more. It's the Jiffy Burger on the Hillsborough Boulevard in Manchester. Call in orders at 728-4452. You can also order at the convenient outdoor curb service. Hamburgers are made the old-fashioned way. At the Jiffy Burger, Manchester's finest hamburgers. Open 7:30 until 9, Monday through Saturday.
We would like to thank Dr. David Florence for supporting Let's Talk Antiques. See Dr. Florence at 804 Kalon Street in Manchester for all of your medical needs. Call 728-5522 for your appointment today. Most insurances accepted.
Hey everybody, we're back with Talking Antiques, and the number here is 728-1320.
All right, that's that boy Max. I'll tell you, I saw him this morning. He was going through Hardee's.
Yeah.
Said they was going to be wrapping presents. I don't know whether he meant for us or his family, but that's what I told him. I said, well, I know David and everybody be looking forward to that.
Yeah. Before the show's over, he should be back here with presents.
Well, look,
presents
then, shouldn't
we? Don't care how you get them here, Max. Just bring them.
Yeah, bring them on, Max.
Okay.
You got so some more Maryland stuff?
We got some more Maryland stuff. We have a Marilyn Monroe-owned fur and signed photo. Museum framed, certificate of authenticity included, and they were asking $8,000 and took a best offer on that, but it was probably pretty close to that.
Mm-hmm.
It's very nice. It's like a full fur coat on that. Let's see, we had another one. Here's a early signed magazine from 1948, which went for $5,500 with five bids. We had a set of six original rare photographs from the 50s, went for $4,800. Marilyn Monroe personally autographed photo, framed with owned and worn gloves from her.
Yeah, it's got a picture of her, and I guess that must be the letter on it.
Yeah, and it was $5,000. They took a best offer on that one. Here's another person. We were talking about checks from the Beatles the other day.
Mm-hmm.
And here's a Marilyn Monroe signed check from 1953, PSA certified.
Which I trust.
They were asking $4,300 and took a best offer on that, but still.
What's that next one? Oh, it's Joe DiMaggio.
Joe DiMaggio and Marilyn Monroe autographed composition page. So it's a page out of a composition book where both of them signed it.
Mm-hmm.
$4,250 of four bids on that. And it comes, there's a photo on it to go with it. Let's see if we have anything different on there. That looks like about it. Okay.
All right.
We'll go on to...
What's our next item?
Anne Frank. Okay. A poem by Anne Frank sold recently for $150,000.
Yeah, wow. But just four lines of the eight were hers.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, she just added on to one.
Mm-hmm. So... In the Netherlands, a few months before Anne Frank and her family were uprooted from their secret apartment hiding place and betrayed to the Nazi Gestapo, soldiers in Amsterdam in March of 1942, she wrote an encouraging note to her friend Christine. The short poem sold in auction last month for $148,620. A high price that auctioneers thought was a sign of the enduring popularity of the young Jewish diarist who had become a symbol for the Holocaust victims. The top half of the eight-line poem was copied from a Dutch book dated March 28, 1942, but the last four lines were her own. And it was, "If others have reproached you for what you have done wrong, then be sure to amend your mistake. That is the best answer one can make." The sale was handled by the Dutch auction house Bub Kuiper, and it was estimated it would sell for $30,000 to $50,000. So, nice.
Beat the estimates a little bit, didn't it?
No doubt. The consignee was Anne's former school friend, Jacqueline Van Marsen, according to the auctioneers, who said that the poem had been written by Jacqueline's older sister, who died 10 years ago. Anne died in Bergen-Belsen concentration camp in 1945 at age 15.
Yeah.
I didn't realize she was so young.
Yeah. And everybody knows, I mean, hardly anybody don't recognize the name Anne Frank.
Mm-hmm. The Diary of Anne.
So, have you got some auction stuff?
I do. Is that... Here's the Diary of Anne Frank. Not much detail on it. I assume first edition. It looks nicely preserved. $450 was to buy it now on it. Here's another 1952 first American edition printing. $625 was to buy it now on it. Here's the Diary of Anne Frank review copy. First U.S. edition, $450 was the buy now on that.
And that was 1952 also, wasn't it?
Yeah. Iconic, here's Anne Frank at her school desk portrait press photo. $265 was that with 10 bids. Let's see, it's more copies of the book.
Who is that lady there, that postcard? It has something to do with Anne Frank.
Yeah. It's a German name that I don't know how to pronounce.
Yeah, but I mean.
So, let's see. Meet Guys, signed 4x6 postcard autograph.
What's the description say down there? Anything?
What do we get? This was Anne Frank's protector.
Oh, okay.
They kept her hidden, her and her family.
All right. So it was a postcard.
Oh, so it's an autographed 4x6 postcard.
Yeah.
There you go. It went for $150.
Remember how the chair it sold three times? You know, they sold it for charity?
Mm-hmm.
What is that right
that
there?
The chair she was sitting in.
Is that
closet?
Another book?
Yeah, first edition, okay. 255, just based on condition. Let's see.
I think you about got Anne Frank.
Yeah, I think so. Okay. So, Anne Frank stuff still going for money.
What's our next item?
Next item is a stone with the Ten Commandments inscription.
Now, this is kind of interesting.
Goes on the auction block. Okay. In Beverly Hills, California, the deal was if you bought it, you can't keep it. Last month, Heritage Auctions featured the sale of an ancient biblical stone archaeological artifact with the earliest known complete inscription of the Ten Commandments. The 2-foot square marble stone weighs 115 pounds and dates to the late Roman Byzantine era, somewhere around 300 to 830 AD. It is inscribed with 20 lines of chiseled characters rendered in the Samaritan form of Paleo-Hebrew script. The text is a centerpiece of thoroughly researched and authenticated artifacts owned and offered by New York's Living Torah Museum. It had been purchased in the 1990s by Israeli antiquities dealer Robert Deutsch, who was later obtained by Rabbi Saul Deutsch for his Living Torah Museum. The auction house said that the Israeli antiques authorities approved U.S. export of the tablet in 2005 with the stipulation that the stone would always be on public display at a museum. With bidding starting at $200,000, it sold in auction last month for $850,000.
Wow.
To an anonymous buyer who acknowledges that he owns a historic stone, but he can't keep it among his personal possessions.
Yeah, but there's some interesting other facts about it.
According to Heritage, the stone was first uncovered in 1913 during excavations for a railroad station in western Israel and was originally used for stone flooring in a private owner's courtyard. Plans are being developed for when and where to display the rare artifact.
Can you imagine
stone flooring?
It was part of a stone floor.
I would love to have that on David's front porch and neon lights in this country.
Yeah.
That's pretty
Me
amazing.
Too. Right? I'd love to have it.
No doubt. Okay.
Okay, so
very interesting.
Is there anything Ten Commandments?
Well, you know, when you
That's pretty
Ten Commandment related, you get things like the top selling thing was a pair of Egyptian stabs from the Ten Commandments movie, which sold as a buy it now for $3,000.
Mm-hmm.
You've got a 1970
that judge in Alabama ought to be in there.
Yeah. Well, it wasn't 1956. Ten Commandments poster looks like a French poster, I believe, for the movie that was $1,170 for the buy it now on that. That came from Spain. Maybe that's Spanish, and I don't know my language as well. Salvador Dali, the Ten Commandments medals, which are 10 medallions that artist Salvador Dali made with 50 millimeter of pure silver each, 1975, sold for $995. Mm. Those are really nice.
Mm-hmm.
Here's another set of those that went for $621. And then they're pieced out as that would go for around 500 each. Let's see if we got something that's different. Here's a complete set of 1 ounce silver bars with Ten Commandments on them. Hamilton Mint, $390 is a buy it now on that. Salvador Dali, 1967 lithographed, signed with a certificate of authenticity. It only went for $372, 11 bids.
Huh, that's odd. Give us one more thing. We got to take a break.
Okay. Here is a nice 24 karat gold plate with the Ten Commandments written in Hebrew. It went for $375 with 4 bids. So, there you go.
All right, with that, let's take a break.
You are listening to Let's Talk Antiques on Thunder Radio. Do you need a part for your car that the dealer just wants too much money for? We'll bring your toolbox and pull the part yourself for huge savings at the CFC Auto Salvage Pick and Pull on Highway 55 between Tullahoma and Manchester. No walking through waist-high weeds here. All of our vehicles are located in our graveled parking lot, up on blocks with room to work. We stock hundreds of cars and trucks, foreign and domestic, new and old, with new vehicles added weekly. You can even search our entire vehicle inventory online. And if your old vehicle gives up the ghost, bring it by. We offer top dollar for your salvage vehicle. Open to the public 7 days a week until dark, so there's plenty of time to come by. That's CFC Auto Salvage Pick and Pull.
Madeline's Antiques and Uniques at 6107 Murfreesboro Road in Manchester has been helping collectors find just the right thing since 2008. With 40 quality dealers and a constantly changing inventory of collectibles from the 1800s to the present, they have many unique items in the store and new things coming in daily. Are you looking for the perfect lamp or clock to finish your collection? A vintage lunchbox from your childhood? Well, you can find that plus any number of other unique items in their huge building. With their easy access off I-24, they meet many travelers from around the world and just around the corner that come to buy and sell antiques, or just to stop and have a free cup of coffee and a cookie while browsing around the store. Come visit owner Madeline Kemp and travel back in time at Madeline's Antiques and Uniques. So many memories.
My name's John Hirschman. I'm one of the original six owners of P&H Rentals. Started the company 30 years ago when we saw a need for individual, construction, industrial, and commercial storage. We have trailers and containers for lease and sale. Our physical location is 2947 Old Manchester Highway, Tullahoma, Tennessee. My phone number is area code 931-273-4252.
The Jiffy Burger on the Hillsborough Boulevard in Manchester has been voted as having the best hamburgers in Manchester. Hometown atmosphere, historical memorabilia, and of course those great burgers, salads, chicken, and so much more. It's the Jiffy Burger on the Hillsborough Boulevard in Manchester. Call in orders at 728-4452. You can also order at the convenient outdoor curb service. Hamburgers are made the old-fashioned way. At the Jiffy Burger, Manchester's finest hamburgers. Open 7:30 until 9, Monday through Saturday.
We would like to thank Dr. David Florence for supporting Let's Talk Antiques. See Dr. Florence at 804 Kalon Street in Manchester for all of your medical needs. Call 728-5522 for your appointment today. Most insurances accepted.
All right, we're back at Max's. Done it again, but he hadn't showed up with her gifts yet. I've been watching for him.
He'll be here. Just don't count Max out.
You got faith in him.
I have faith in him. Okay. Max.
I don't think he'll make it.
I'm doubting in it, too.
Okay, so during the break, we found... What did we find?
Well, earlier we were talking about the unhatchables, the big gift item this year, and made me think of Tickle Me Elmo and some of the other hot-selling items Christmas time, and I found this list from The Hive, an online publication. And they've gone through the years starting in 1980, and they've listed the top-selling Christmas gifts of each year. And they start in the year 1980, and the Rubik's Cube was the hot item that year. And those were selling for $1.99. Next, in the year 1981, the Lego train set was the hot item. And you could buy that for $70 in 1981. In 1982 was the BMX bike. In 1983, the Cabbage Patch Kids.
Remember the Cabbage Patch Kids? What were they bringing?
Let's see. They sold for $30. This publication has a buy it now price of $63.44. But I've disputed some of these buy it now prices that they've listed. On these other items. 1984 was the year of the Transformers, the Transformer action figures.
Yeah.
The big item that year, $20 was the retail price. In 1985, the Care Bears.
Mm-hmm.
That was the popular item in 85.
How much did it sell for?
The Care Bears went for $25. In 1986, laser tag was the big gift. And that was a $50 item. Came with, I guess, two laser guns. You could wear a shield. The 1987, the Koosh ball was the big item. That was just a $3 or $4 item, kind of like a little Nerf ball that you throw around.
We're still talking about pre-eBay items here.
Mm-hmm.
In 1988, the Ghostbuster toys. That was the big hit. Mm-hmm. And that packaged item went for $9. Then in 89, the Game Boy was introduced, and that sold for $189.
Ooh.
From Nintendo.
That's a lot of money in 89.
Then in 1990, the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles was popular, and those action figures went for about $6 each. In 1991, Sega introduced the Game Gear, another portable gaming console to compete with the Game Boy. Let's see, that was $150. In 1992, WWF action figures went for about $7 each. Here's one you might remember from 1993, the Talk Boy, a little recording device made popular by the Home Alone movies.
Mm-hmm.
And those went for $30 retail price. And then 1994, the Power Rangers. The Power Ranger toys, $10 each for those action figures. In 95, Pogs was a big collector's item. You remember mm-hmm. Pogs? $3, it says, for the retail price, I guess, for a sleeve of Pogs. In 96 was Tickle Me Elmo, and $30 was the starting price for that. 1997, the Tamagotchi, for $20. Tamagotchi was a small electronic device about the size of a pager or beeper you could wear around your waist or on your keychain. And it was kind of like a digital pet, and you'd have to feed it and put it to bed and whatever. It would send you notifications. It's time to eat.
What a thrill.
I'm sure there's an app for
and
that
some
now.
Kids
I'm
there.
Hungry. Feed me.
In 98, a different kind of pet was introduced. The Furby doll was popular in 98. Those sold for about $35. In 99, Pokemon was the big deal.
Mm-hmm.
And let's see, the Pokemon Nintendo games sold for about $30. In 2000, the Razor scooter mm-hmm. was the big toy. That was about a $100 gift. In 2001, the Bratz dolls were popular. $20 for a Bratz doll. In 2002, Beyblades. Those sold for about $8. I don't remember Beyblades.
It was some kind of game where you would like battling tops, and they would spin and knock each other down.
Hmm. Okay, like Pogs on steroids, I guess. 2003, Robo Sapien was a robot toy that sold for $100. In 2004, it was the Nintendo DS. Sold for $150. In 2005, the Xbox 360 went for $300. In 2006, the PS3 sold for $400. In 2007, the iPod Touch was a $300 item. In 2008, Elmo Live was the popular item. That was a $60 buy. In 2009, the Nintendo Wii sold for $200. In 2010, the Apple iPad sold for $500. And in 2011, the Kindle Fire for $200. And their list ends in 2011. Mm. So in the 80s, you have these small toys that you hold in your hand for less than $10. And then you get to the 2000s, and it's all video game systems
$200, $300.
Yeah.
Were hot back then, and they are now, aren't they?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
You've got a new one that's come out?
Oh, a what?
Oh. You found us a new one there?
Oh, yeah, okay. The Nintendo Mini Classic Edition that was released in November, but nobody can get them.
So guess what happens when nobody can get them?
When nobody can get them, somebody gets them and they go on eBay. The top selling one went for $99,000, so they buy it now. And I looked at the auction and the guy said, you know, he was saying how awesome you would be if you were the one that paid $90,000 for this. And don't worry, I won't buy drugs with the money, and I'll send you a picture of me and my family with it.
Oh, and all the way to the bank.
Absolutely. And then November 13th, he got $99,000 for it.
Yeah.
The second highest sale was $75,000. It says it's going to be delivered by Santa. And probably for that much, I would travel across the country and deliver it at Santa suit.
Clinton Foundation.
And then what does it drop down to?
And then it drops. Those are the two outrageous, well, most outrageous ones. And then it drops down to $15,000. But this one comes with a second controller because the box only comes with one controller, and you have to buy a second controller.
Mm.
Yeah. Then it drops down to $10,000 with a second controller. There's a whole bunch of them that sold for $10,000.
And how much they costing you?
$60.
Gosh.
That's what eBay's done.
And you heard it first on Let's Talk Antiques.
Man, right. I wish I'd gone out and ordered, one of those from somewhere. Because
you could have bought a case of them.
It only comes with 30 games, and it's like handheld. It connects to your TV. Looks the controller's like the original Nintendo controller. It's not. You can download all these games already.
Yeah, but it probably costs $50. It probably comes $50 to a case or something. So just think how much you could have made.
Man, you could have made a lot of money if you were.
You probably wouldn't even be here today.
Just let it auction. You don't even have
You'd
to
be on vacation.
Crazy by it now.
He wouldn't expect to be.
No, he wouldn't.
There you go.
No.
Here's one that the highest one that went for auction went for $2,500. So I mean, so with
38 bids.
Yeah.
All
over it. So they're going. You know, if you just let it run up an auction and give the people what they're willing to pay for it, it'll, you know. You can still make $2,500 off of each one.
So you know those vintage video games, though, some of them bring a lot of money, don't they?
Mm-hmm. Some of them, yeah. There you go.
All right. Okay, so
we're going from games.
We're going
to a wooden leg.
From games to a wooden leg. Okay, so if you remember the Alamo. The Battle of the Alamo, it ended in 1836, but the battle wages on over General Santa Anna's wooden leg. 11 years after losing his leg, and while fleeing U.S. soldiers at the Battle of Cerro Gordo in Mexico in 1847, Santa Anna left his wooden leg behind in a military war carriage, along with a chicken lunch and $18,000.
That's a lot of money.
That was a lot of money back then.
He must have been in a hurry. If you're leaving that much money.
And you leave your leg, you're in a hurry. You know they wanted him.
And your chicken dinner, don't forget that. Yeah.
But now, he didn't have the wooden leg at the Alamo.
No, at the Alamo he had both legs.
Shortly after he lost his leg.
Yeah.
Okay, so the unique historical artifact has been held as a war souvenir by the soldiers that chased him. Okay, according to the curators of the Illinois State Military Museum, soldiers from the state's National Guard who were part of the fight, and they recovered the leg, they ate his lunch, and then they returned the money.
They kept his leg, though.
They kept his leg, though. Yeah. And today, his leg is one of the prized exhibits of their museum.
In Illinois.
It's a castle-shaped museum at the state's capital.
And I think it's kind of unique that, you know, we talk about the National Guard today. You know, they've been on a lot of missions. Mm-hmm. I mean, if anything, they're overworked.
Yeah.
But, I mean, they were using the National Guard back then.
Way, but yeah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the Civil War was mostly white state militias,
mm-hmm.
fought by state militias.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but from St. Mary's University in San Antonio, there's a new battle cry. The students want the leg repatriated to Mexico. So the drive to return the leg, and it's made out of wood and cork and leather. It's being held by students there.
Still has his boot on it.
Yes, it still has his boot on it. It's a nice looking leg, really. You know, for a prosthetic leg.
Yeah, one of them lamp legs.
It's kind of fancy, really.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it was hand carved, you know, for sure.
Yeah.
But I'll guarantee you that leg is not going nowhere. I mean, the Mexicans. Mm. Government probably wants it.
That's exactly what.
But it ain't going to happen.
It's going to help build a wall.
The museum staffers are saying exactly that the leg isn't going anywhere. And they said the answer's always been no, and it'll continue to be no. Because that's their prized exhibit, you know. Yeah. That's what people come to the museum to see.
Let's take a break, and we'll go back to the Alamo and see if we can find a few things that sold.
All right.
All right, more Let's Talk Antiques on the way next on Thunder Radio.
Do you need a part for your car that the dealer just wants too much money for? We'll bring your toolbox and pull the part yourself for huge savings at the CFC Auto Salvage Pick and Pull on Highway 55 between Tullahoma and Manchester. No walking through waist-high weeds here. All of our vehicles are located in our graveled parking lot, up on blocks with room to work. We stock hundreds of cars and trucks, foreign and domestic, new and old, with new vehicles added weekly. You can even search our entire vehicle inventory online. And if your old vehicle gives up the ghost, bring it by. We offer top dollar for your salvage vehicle. Open to the public 7 days a week until dark, so there's plenty of time to come by. That's CFC Auto Salvage Pick and Pull.
Madeline's Antiques and Uniques at 6107 Murfreesboro Road in Manchester has been helping collectors find just the right thing since 2008. With 40 quality dealers and a constantly changing inventory of collectibles from the 1800s to the present, they have many unique items in the store and new things coming in daily. Are you looking for the perfect lamp or clock to finish your collection? A vintage lunchbox from your childhood? Well, you can find that plus any number of other unique items in their huge building. With their easy access off I-24, they meet many travelers from around the world and just around the corner that come to buy and sell antiques, or just to stop and have a free cup of coffee and a cookie while browsing around the store. Come visit owner Madeline Kemp and travel back in time at Madeline's Antiques and Uniques. So many memories.
My name's John Hirschman. I'm one of the original six owners of P&H Rentals. Started the company 30 years ago when we saw a need for individual, construction, industrial, and commercial storage. We have trailers and containers for lease and sale. Our physical location is 2947 Old Manchester Highway, Tullahoma, Tennessee. My phone number is area code 931-273-4252.
The Jiffy Burger on the Hillsborough Boulevard in Manchester has been voted as having the best hamburgers in Manchester. Hometown atmosphere, historical memorabilia, and of course, those great burgers, salads, chicken, and so much more. It's the Jiffy Burger on the Hillsborough Boulevard in Manchester. Call in orders at 728-4452. You can also order at the convenient outdoor curb service. Hamburgers are made the old-fashioned way. At the Jiffy Burger, Manchester's finest hamburgers. Open 7:30 until 9, Monday through Saturday.
We would like to thank Dr. David Florence for supporting Let's Talk Antiques. See Dr. Florence at 804 Kalon Street in Manchester for all of your medical needs. Call 728-5522 for your appointment today. Most insurances accepted.
Well, let's talk a little more antiques.
Well, you looked up a few Alamo pieces, didn't you?
Yeah, I've got some. We have a...
Oh, before you even say that, though, my daughter texted us, and she wanted everybody to know there was another item that was a hot item, and I don't remember what year, but Jake the Snake.
Jake the Snake.
Anybody remember him?
No.
Okay.
I know of a wrestler by the name.
Tracy, I'm old, but I don't remember that one. But no.
Anyway.
Okay.
It's been that long ago.
Oh, it hadn't.
Maybe about 10 or 15 years ago.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is that what it was, the wrestler?
I think it was an actual snake. You know, it was a green snake. Well, here, I'll tell you what.
We'll look it up here.
That's going to have to be one of them eBay things. Let me look it up and see.
I eBayed it, and there's these action figures for the wrestler, Jake the Snake.
Yeah.
Was that the popular item?
I think
item?
It was an actual toy that was a snake. Add toy to your search and see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
Still getting lots of action figure results.
Maybe we'll get another text.
Okay.
I haven't seen a snake yet.
It's a remote control snake called Jake the Snake.
Because
Tracy says she bought me one and paid a ton for it.
Oh, well.
Wow.
I bought my smallest one those last year.
I've still got it in the box, so I never did open it up.
I
didn't play with him.
Ours got hairs wrapped all around the wheels and burned up.
I figured it had to be a rock and roll band or either a wrestler name.
All right, so now we're back to Alamo, right?
Okay, so we've got a William Barrett Travis, who was a soldier at the Alamo. His 1835 Republic of Texas land document, which is a land transaction with him and Henry Austin Bolivar, and the land document went for $1,598.32 with 19 bids.
Pretty good for a piece of paper.
Yeah, not bad. From the Battle of the Alamo and a leather gunpowder flask went for $1,120 as a buy it now. We have a handle axe from the Alamo. $975 was a buy it now on that. Order of Service book. Used during the Battle of the Alamo, $920. And then we get into stuff that says style of it. And things like cast iron banks for $329 of the Alamo. So.
Oh, that newspaper there is pretty neat.
Hey, and by the way, the Alamo does not have a basement. Remember when Pee Wee Herman was hunting his bicycle and somebody told him that...
It was not, was it? Here is a 1836 newspaper that speaks about the Texas War of Independence with the first battle report from the Alamo. They were asking $500 and took a best offer on that.
Hey, by the way, Jake the Snake, 1999.
Okay. Well,
all right, we'll turn
it was an actual snake then and stuff.
Yeah, right. With a remote control.
Now, I wonder how they really know that that was from the Alamo. I don't see any certificates of authenticity on that. Yeah.
No, there was none that said that there was a certificate of authenticity with them.
Yeah, probably none will.
You can just trust them.
Oh, yeah, I trust everybody on eBay.
Yeah. You know? That's like Facebook. Everything you read is absolutely the truth.
Of course. And, you know, they have the best certificates of authenticity. You know, they top them out and sign them themselves. And if they say it's true, it's true. It's not PSA or something like that. I don't really...
You know, I might have a rare item, Tracy, because everybody's looked for Jake the Snake, and he hadn't pulled up.
May have to do a little more research on Jake.
Yeah. We
know he was born in 1999. We do know that about Jake the Snake, don't we?
It was a fairly expensive item, she said?
Yeah, it was real... What happened was, like everything else, it was a hot item and very few of them. Guess what happens? You know, you just seen what happens. They get high priced.
Yeah.
If you want one.
Why can't we find it?
I don't know.
Oh, I like that face. Yeah. Oh, there's a new Star Trek movie coming out.
Star Wars. I saw
Star Trek.
Star Wars.
There's a new Star Trek TV series.
Yeah, Star Wars is
out.
Already out. It's been out since Friday.
Have you Thursday. Been? Thursday. I went Thursday.
Oh, yours.
You were
going
to report on that today.
Yeah. Well. Okay. Well, do you want me to?
You need to give us your report.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. My report on the new Star Wars movie.
You got that mic close enough?
It's basically. I mean, most people probably know what it's about. It's about pretty much the month before the first Star Wars movie takes place, the original 1977 New Hope. So it's where they steal the plans to the or get the plans to the Death Star in order to where they knew that they could shoot down that hole at the end of the first movie to blow it up.
You say you're loading into R2-D2 at the very beginning of the
right. So it was in my opinion, it was really for the the big fans of Star Wars, because there were like little things that they would show planet so-and-so, and then they would have like a scene from that planet, and planet so-and-so. Yeah, and it was all these things that if you weren't a Star Wars fan,
you wouldn't know.
It would just be tons of information flying at you. But it was a great action movie. It was, and the special effects were true to the original. It didn't look all computer generated, except for that one character who died that they've brought
Yoda.
In. No, like it was.
No,
it was,
there were no Jedis in this one, were there?
There was a little bit, but not exactly.
What about Darth Vader?
Vader was in for just a tiny amount. But there was a character who the actor died like several years ago. And they had him in the movie computer generated. And the friend of mine that I went with thought it was kind of cool. I thought it kind of looked like a video game.
Oh, no, it's about
you,
too.
Hey, guess what? You might as well just fold your paper up there. We only got 1 minute, so go ahead. Is there any other particular thing about the movie?
Particular things about the movie, it was, like I say, overall I enjoyed it. I'm to the point where I'm starting to be picky on them, so I don't know. I don't really trust my own thing as to whether to tell somebody bad things about it or not.
But there's still some hope in our world.
Yeah. Hey, by the way,
I hope Michelle Obama heard that.
By the way, you can Google Jake the Snake remote control. And he does come up.
Okay, I looked for that on eBay and didn't find
Fisher,
it for sale.
Fisher Price calls it Slithering Jake.
Yeah.
And you can still buy one for about $20.
$20. All right.
And it's a remote control. It can go forward, backwards, and the eyes light up.
All right.
So, Slithering Jake the Snake.
Okay.
If something caused you to hurt yourself, wouldn't me.
We got to get out of here.
All right, we'll wrap it up. Put a bow on it. It's Let's Talk Antiques. We'll do it again next week. We're live Wednesdays from 10 to 11 on Thunder Radio.